What is this noble eightfold way? These eight things, friends, when developed and cultivated, lead to nirvana. Have the deathless nirvana as the ultimate destination. Have nirvana as a final goal. What aid? Right view, right motivation, right speech, right action, right livelihood, right effort, right awareness, and right concentration. Friends, true knowledge is initiating all advantageous states with a sense of shame and fear of wrongdoing coming right after. For any clever person who has arrived at such true knowledge, right view emerges. For one of right view, right motivation improves. For one of right motivation, right speech evolves. For one of right speech, right action springs up. For one of right action, right livelihood comes into being. For one of right livelihood, right effort arises. For one of right effort, right awareness appears. For one of right awareness, right concentration develops. Friends, this is a sign and precursor for the rising of the sun, dawn. So too, friends, for any person, this is a sign and precursor for the rising of the noble eightfold way. That is good and noble friendship. When a person has a good, noble friend, it is to be expected that he will develop and cultivate this noble eightfold way. And how does a person who has a good friend develop and cultivate this noble eightfold way? Here, friends, a person develops right view, right motivation, right speech, right action, right livelihood, right effort, right awareness, and right concentration, which has as its final goal the complete elimination of all greed, the full eradication of all hate, and the final luminous ceasing of all ignorance. There is no other way out of suffering.
Hello to you, friends. Just another What Buddha Six sayings. This time it's called mixed sayings because there's also a saying of Goenka. Unrelevant matters of times of today. But first, the normal intro as usual. And the studio today is the monk's temple, a small place, as you see here, with trickling water and giant ferns and tree roots. And a very, very nice place indeed, cool and shady. But first, the normal intro. Namo Tassu Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha, indeed. The saying goes like this, and this is from the Udana. See here? 2.11. Udana can mean exclamations or inspirations of the Buddha. It is from the Kutaka Nikaya, the fifth text collection, which all lay and monastic Buddhists should read three times in their life before dying. Solitude is happiness for one who is content. One who has heard the Dhamma and who clearly sees. Non-violence is happiness in any world. Harmlessness towards all living beings. Udana 2.11. And then the Goenka verse. Dhamma always gives happiness. True. Dhamma always gives welfare. True. True. Dhamma always gives protection. True. True. Great is the power of the Dhamma. True. True. It's in Goenka. So, what prompted me to take up these verses are actually yet another school shooting, mass shooting in the United States, where they have these 101 guns per 100 inhabitants. This means that little more than one gun per person. And they seem to be, even though this of course clearly is madness, then this madness goes on and on and on. And on. Where kids are shot by other kids in school, kids that are sick, persons that are sick, that are mentally ill, has been picked up by police several times. Still, they can go into any supermarket and buy 10 guns, as this last young man did. 10 semi-automatic rifles, and then go and shoot their fellow beings in a school, which is a karmic catastrophe, and a catastrophe for any society, that such thing still is possible. So, thereby it is again to be noticed that the Buddha came and put the score right by saying the first precept, all training rule that all Buddhists should live up to is I accept the training rule of not killing, of avoiding all killing, of avoiding taking any life. And I made a video, I think it was my first video about it on request, about how to attain peace in society and in the individual mind. And I'll give a link to it up here, several years ago. Of course, one cannot have any peace, mental peace, if you send your kids to school and then you cannot know whether some madness gunman come and guns them down with semi-automatic weapons. You cannot have any peace. And you cannot have any peace of mind anywhere in the American society. Because in hospitals it happens, in airport it happens, habits everywhere. On the street and so on. And this is a major problem. These guns are not needed at all. They cannot protect anyone. Only the Dhamma can protect all beings. Because if one goes in front and say, I will stop killing, then the probability for oneself being killed by shooting or by violence goes down. And this is the greatest offer one can give, the greatest giving and dana and generosity one can give all beings in the society, whether animal or human or whatever. It is to say, I don't kill. I don't accept killing. I will not allow myself to kill anything intentionally. So this is really a big thing. It's the first step that one has to take as a Buddhist. To say, I accept this training rule of avoiding all killing. of avoiding taking any breath, of avoiding taking any life from any live being. Seeing and knowing that all conscious live beings, they love their own life and keep their own life as dear as oneself. How can one take from another what one doesn't like to be taken from oneself? What one considers most precious for oneself, namely one's life? Huh? It's not only hypocrisy, it's insane, basically. Why so? Because the karmic law says that it is impossible to take life without losing life. So this means everyone, one takes life, one chops one's life down. So it's become shorter and shorter and shorter and shorter, both in this life and in all future lives. So it's a, and it's multiplied with something in a factor of in between 1,000 and infinity, actually. So the multiplication factor is extreme. One lose 1,000 times more life than you take, if you take it from an animal, at the minimum. So very expensive, very expensive. Along the same veins, as soon as there is violence, one is violent, non-lethally violent, one doesn't take life, but one harms other beings physically, then sickness, one parks sickness in one's karmic future. Or injuries to the body, traffic accidents, any non-lethal injury to the body. And again, multiplied with a minimum of a factor of 1,000 if it's an animal and 1,000,000 if it's a human being, at the minimum. And possibly infinity if it's a harmless, or 1,000,000 times 1,000,000, that is 1,000,000,000,000 if it's a harmless human one touches and harms physically, either by stick or by hitting or by punching or by knife or in whatever way, intentionally harming, injuring their body to cause sickness in the future, karmically speaking. So therefore nonviolence, of course, this sickness then is very difficult to be happy when you're sick, when all this sickness come flooding in. You pain here and there, you get a cancer here and there, you get a sore throat, a headache here and there. You don't remember that this was caused long time ago because of lack of mindfulness and lack of seeing deeper chakra, lack of seeing the former lives of oneself and the harm one did there under influence of ignorance of the karmic law, of not knowing the karmic law. Expensive. Expensive. So if one has heard this Dhamma, this truth, this absolute truth, then needless to say, and one clearly sees the consequences and the causes, that is madness and anger, basically, then it's easier to stop violence and stop taking life, stop killing, much more easy. So it's true what he says, the Buddha, as always. Nonviolence is happiness in all worlds, in all worlds. It promotes happiness right here now when you're nonviolent, and it promotes happiness to oneself down the lane also, in any future. Because one has taken the way, the cause, the karmic cause of illness, sickness, physical injury in the future. This one has taken away. So it cannot come in the future. It's gone. This leaves the door open for happiness to arise, because the body is fit for being content. This is the first line. Solitude is happiness for one who is content. And this I can really, 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 really personally witness, and I do it every day, every day, every day, that I am really happy because I'm alone. It's therefore I'm happy. As soon as the other beings come here with mental defilements in the airport size, then it becomes difficult to be a happy monk. Because then I have to be the doctor for them, without them knowing it, and without them agreeing in the Dhamma as the medicine. Tricky business, possible sometimes, not always, but often not exactly easy. But alone, not wanting company, not wanting sex, drugs and rock and roll, not wanting entertainment, not needing anything from other beings except food and a little bit of clothes and a little bit housing and a little bit medicine to sustain this body. Then one can boil it down to a minimum interaction that gives this solitude where if one is content, not needing anything, not wanting anything, not urging for anything, not hoping for anything, not planning for anything. Endlessly planning for this and that, blah, blah, up and down the doorway. If not so, then this contentment will automatically translate into happiness. Because why not be happy when if you're content and there's solitude, this means there's peace. There's no dirt except your own minimal dirt that can't be handled. There's no external dirt from other beings. Then solitude is happiness by seeing this Dhamma, living with this Dhamma, gorging, diving in this Dhamma, every day, every day, every day. Solitude has another, the Pali word here is viveka. And viveka actually is three things. There's physical viveka, that's being secluded from society and worldly bustle and company. To the largest extent, basically being alone, ideally, ideal solitude. Then it also means another thing, that's citta viveka, it means secluded from the mental defilements. So one is secluded from greed, hate and ignorance, jealousy, restlessness, laziness, envy, speculation, worries, doubt, uncertainty, skepticism, confusion, hesitation, and so on. One is secluded from that. This is the second level of seclusion, viveka, being alone. The third is being secluded from all constructions, which is a synonym of nirvana. Then when one has gone to a place where one is secluded, protected, alone, so to speak, from all things that can cause suffering, and therefore it's impossible for one to suffer. That's a goal. So as soon as one stays with this Dhamma, then as Goenka says, then it gives happiness. It gives happiness. It gives welfare to anyone who stays with it. And for all this person's interacting with him, then it also gives welfare. And it gives protection, of course, because all these who take up the Dhamma, they become harmless by nature. Harmless, harmless, harmless. Ahimsa, as Mahatma Gandhi called it, ahimsa. So this, that one thing, the Dhamma can give both happiness, welfare, and protection. There's not many other things that can give that. Not even one of them. So therefore it's true what Goenka says, great is the power of the Dhamma. Great. Silence is bliss. solitude is happiness for one who is content, who has heard the Dhamma and who clearly sees. Non-violence is happiness in all worlds. Harmlessness towards all beings. Udana 2:11. Dhamma always give happiness. Dhamma always gives welfare, advantage. Dhamma always gives protection against harmful effects from inside and from outside as well. Thank you for your advantageous attention, clever consideration, and kind contribution. And by that, Namo Tassu Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha indeed. And may you indeed have a nice and noble day. Thank you.
You heard Bhikkhu Samahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pamparela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha. Thank you for your contribution, and have a nice day.